There we go. All right, so this is, I like to get started just by touching bases and getting to know you a little bit better. So, you know, I'd like for you to share your name and a little bit about your family and church background. And then if you have any particular hopes for this class, and you feel comfortable sharing those, that would be great. If anybody feels like, you know, I just don't feel comfortable talking in a group, especially on Zoom, you can just say I pass, okay? And there's no shame in that at all. So so these are the questions that I want us to tackle. I'm gonna expand us over here like that. So I'll start. So obviously my name is Pastor Bill Crabtree, and I've been pastor at Silverdale Lutheran since 2007 as the lead pastor with Pastor Jonathan. We had Pastor Paula for many years. She took a new call just not too long ago. I have two daughters. They are both young adults. One is 29 and one is 28 and 25. And they're out in the world working. My youngest works for Nordstrom in the, used to be the finance, now in the marketing side of things. And my oldest works for Derek Kilmer, our congressman, as his community liaison in this area. My wife, who I've been married to for over 33 years, is superintendent of Port Townsend School District currently. She's finishing that mid-June and gonna be back here closer to home. So that's a little bit about my family. Both of my folks have passed away. I grew up in Phoenix. Got one brother who still lives in the Phoenix area. Went to college in Cal Lutheran and then seminary in Pacific Lutheran Theological Seminary. But I won't go into all of that. But that's a little bit of a quick brushstroke about my journey and my story. We'll get to hear more about that later. So that's church background. I grew up in the Lutheran Church, Missouri Synod. If you don't know what that is, no problem. There's a bunch of different groups of Lutherans in the United States, and we'll probably talk about some of that in our class. It was a great upbringing. My hopes for this class is that all of you get to ask all of the tough questions, and that your hopes in, and that this furthers you on in your relationship to Christ and to his church. So, so that's me. Who wants to go next?
I'd like to go next, I guess. Sure. My name is Ed Sigrist.
Let's see. You know what? Let's try Carolyn unmuting and then you stay muted. Let's try see how that sounds.
Okay. Okay, Ed.
You're unmuted?
I am. I'm unmuted on Zoom.
That's better. That's actually better, Ed. If you can just go ahead, we can hear
it. Yeah. My name is Ed Sigrist. My wife, Carolyn, is in one of the other screens. I was born in Lincoln, Nebraska. I joined the Navy after college and married Carolyn. We've traveled for about 30 years with the Navy. We traveled after that for about 10 years volunteering in national parks. And we have a home in Seebeck, Washington. We have two boys, about 50, one's about 53, the other is about 48. They're both off doing what guys do. We have two granddaughters by our oldest son on the East Coast. Our other son is on the West Coast. How many of you have that kind of a problem? So that's sort of who we are. Maybe Carolyn can give us a little bit of our church background.
Okay, can you hear me? All right. Well, as Ed said, we've done a lot of traveling. In fact, we just got back from Whidbey Island about 20 minutes ago from camping up there and going to the Tulip Festival. I wasn't going to tell the ages of our sons, but since he did already, Ed and I have been married to each other for 55 years.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, long time. My church background, I grew up in Kentucky in a church, very, fundamental, legalistic Church mm-hmm. of Christ. Gave me a good background, but it also gave me a lot of confusion. And when we finally settled down after traveling for 30 plus years in Silverdale, we tried the base chapel where we had attended several times before. I think, Pastor Bill, you said you grew up in the Missouri Synod?
Mm-hmm.
Well, the pastor who was the senior chaplain was a Missouri Synod, and he never made eye contact with the congregation, and he never stopped at the door to shake hands, and he wouldn't serve communion to us. So we decided we needed a home church, and we found the Episcopal Church, St. Charles, up in Poulsbo.
Mm-hmm.
We were there for about 4 years and decided that it wasn't really the right church for us, and we found St. Anthony's. We've been attending St. Anthony's for about the last 18 to 20 years. We've really enjoyed it. We love the church family there, but the priest who's there now is a nice, nice guy, but we're not being fed. We're getting pablum for the last few years. And I have done both Ed and I have done some extensive study of the Bible through Bible Study Fellowship International. And mm-hmm. for the last several weeks have been watching Silverdale Lutheran Church on our computer via AirDrop on the TV. And we feel like we're being fed. We love the service. The Eucharist is very much the same as we had at St. Anthony's. And that is one thing that's important to me, is the Eucharist. And so I look forward to attending services there in person. We have been there a couple of times, Christmas Eve, 7 p.m. service, and the 9 a.m. Easter service, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So we've enjoyed it, but you know, wearing masks and it's a little different.
It is. So. It is. Thank you, Carolyn. That's really helpful. And I see I'm getting blasted by the sun here, and I'll get up and shut my blinds in a minute. But yeah, thank you. That's a beautiful background, and I'm just delighted that you're getting the word at SLC at this point. So, and having your faith nurtured. So very cool. Thank you both. Wow. Well, congratulations on 55 years.
Thank
That's
you.
Incredible. That's awesome. Okay. You know, if we were sitting around in a class as Lutherans, we do everything in good order. So we'd go in order, but since, you know, everybody's screen different, you know, you're just gonna have to jump in. So anyway, who wants to go next?
We can go next.
Perfect.
And I'm
blind, Teresa, so keep going.
My name is Teresa Gaines, and this is Brian Walton. Brian is my fiance, and I have already been through the foundations class. So I'm roping Brian through, and I found Silverdale Lutheran Church 3 or 4 years ago, I think. And I was very fed. So Carolyn, I like how you said that, I was fed. I've grown up in the area. Poulsbo is where I grew up. And Brian, I should probably let him talk. He grew up in Bremerton. I've always been a part of a Lutheran church. It just sort of seems to happen wherever I have moved. It seems that's where I navigate to. My family's still in the area. We live ourselves in Bremerton, and we're getting married next weekend. and Pastor Bill's officiating. We're really excited. We have an Australian shepherd that's under the table here and hopefully won't make noise while we're here. He's 10 months old. and he's a handful.
Wow.
I'll let Brian do a little bit of talking.
I'm Brian Walton. I was born and raised in Bremerton here. I worked at the shipyard for 37 years. I retired as a mechanical engineer for the Navy. I've been retired for about 3 years. Our family actually started out there in Seebeck area back in the 1880s. So our family's been in this area for quite a long time.
Lots of roots.
Yeah. some of the things I like to do, well, haven't done for the last year, but get out there fishing, crabbing, mountaineering. I like to do the mountaineering. I used to help out with Olympic College as one of the rope leaders with Kent Hevershaw. It's sad that Olympic College let that go, but that's the way things go these days. But my religion, I've been Lutheran. My mom brought me up as Lutheran and I stayed that route. So
yeah,
I don't know what, that's about it.
That's great. That's great, Brian. Yeah. Well, I'm delighted. I know Teresa got to take the class before and I'm glad that you guys are doing this together. It's a great part of getting married and I'm looking for, I've gotten to know Brian a little bit and are getting ready for their marriage and I'm looking forward to lots of good questions. So, all right. Thank you. Thank you, Teresa and Brian.
Thank you.
Please, Sharon. Let's see. Let me ask you to unmute there. There we go.
I keep it muted because I have three dogs who love to bark at the moment's notice too. And it's like, again, Sharon Malis. I moved here about a year ago last June. I live with my daughter. She's got an apartment down in the basement. So I'm living here. Didn't really get out and do much, obviously, with COVID. When it started opening up, I started looking mainly online for some place to go. I have been, well, my father was Marine Corps, 30 years Marine. So we did traveling back and forth in the country. And he was a Church of Christ. My mother was Presbyterian. But occasionally we went to Lutheran churches, kind of wherever was handy and close by wherever we lived. But after I more or less always kind of went Presbyterian afterwards but I think I have that moving thing because about every 3-4 years, I feel like I need to pick up and move. So I think it's just ingrained in me.
Yeah.
But I always seem to go for Presbyterian and find a Presbyterian church. Well, besides moving back and forth all over, I thought I was going to live down in Costa Rica. My son lives down there and is married a Tika. And I thought I was going to be able to stay down there. And I don't know, after a while, I don't speak the language fluently. And I just started feeling isolated. Hospitals were an hour away. And I saw the handwriting on the wall. So my daughter and her husband are also military. He's in the Navy. But his family was from Missouri. So I ended up moving to Washington, Missouri. And spent the first 2 years kind of like not doing anything, not really joining a church and whatever until I felt like I really needed to reach out. Went one time to the Presbyterian church and it just didn't feel like a good fit for some reason. So I got online and did some Googling of the churches around and came up with a United Church of Christ, which, you know, I heard Church of Christ and I was like, maybe not. But I did some checking on it and found that between going and finding out what they really believe in and what I found a home, in other words, the people were friendly. I was able to get involved probably more than I should have with Women's Fellowship on the council, just volunteering for just about anything and everything. but it was home, and the ladies there and everyone was just really super, super friendly. So brings me here and felt like a fish out of water. And I'm thinking, okay, where do I go? Did some Googling again and came up with a couple churches that were closer to me. I'm in Bremerton too. And I just got on there and it just seemed like it was right. I looked up the synod that this is, and it just, I don't know, it struck me as very, very close to what UCC was and felt like home. So I come, I think, two Sundays and planning on coming this coming Sunday. And I thought I'd get in slowly, but taking this foundation class. So what I'm hoping to gain, going back, I have three kids. I have one in Costa Rica. I have one in Boston area that's way too cold. And then my daughter who lives here, three dogs, which two of which were from Costa Rica. So I've got more than I can handle there. Don't ever want to do that again. But anyway, hopes is just, I want to learn about the church here. And I have been very impressed because of the two times I've gone, people have gone out of the way to say hi to me and make me feel welcome. And that's a really good start. So I appreciate that. Anyway, that's me.
Thank you, Sharon. That's cool. I don't know, as a former member of a UCC church, our church-wide body, the ELCA, the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, is in full communion with the United Church of Christ, and the Reformed Church, and the Presbyterian Church USA. So anyway, I'm glad that the fits.
Oh, I was impressed by the fact that it's open and affirming, kind mm-hmm. of like what they were, and that just, and I also, I really found that I had been raised pretty strict on what the Bible said and reading the Bible. Mm-hmm. And that was the first time going in and being able to question or, you know, not have to read a specific Bible. It was okay to read other versions. And, mm-hmm. and it was like an eye opener, you know, yeah. finally in my life that you could ask questions about it. So yeah. that felt good too.
Yeah. Well, we'll get into some of those, the open and affirming questions and journey and conversation here towards the one, some of the latter classes. But I want to say that I just wrote a blog about this, that, you know, we don't ask people to leave their brain at the door here. You know, we have convictions and beliefs. I like to think of our church as being grounded in the Orthodox Christian Church, the great tradition of the church over the centuries, but we'll get into all of that for sure. So yeah, well, that's awesome. Thank you for sharing. Great part of your journey. So it's just your one daughter who's here now then.
Right, right. And my granddaughter and son-in-law. So
gotcha. Yeah. Gotcha. Cool. All right. Couple others.
Hi there. So I'm Jamie and this is Evan. My husband and I have seven children. So Evan is one of seven. And kind of our main reason for coming is Evan was just wanting to learn a little more and I wanted to learn a little more. I come from a Lutheran family, but I did not attend church as a young person. And about 20 years ago, I stumbled into a church on Bainbridge Island and I met Pastor Paula and she baptized me and she baptized my three youngest. So I kind of had lost track as, you know, moving here and there just around. And when I came back, I found out she was in Silverdale. So I followed her to Silverdale. So about 10 years, I've gone on and off to Silverdale Lutheran. We live out in Hansville, so it's a pretty far drive to Silverdale. So I really did love during the pandemic. You know, we watch every Sunday and I listen to all the, you know, devotionals during the week. And so it's just been a really inspiring year for me. So just kind of that reconnection. So my husband and I are both teachers in Kingston. So just excited to kind of learn a little bit more.
Cool. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Evan, do you want to chime in at all, or are you good?
I'm good.
Okay. I'm glad you're here, Evan. And, you know, so seven kids, what are the age? Can I ask if?
Yeah. So our youngest is 13. And then Evan is actually a twin, and her brother will be 17 next week. And then we have twins that are going to be 21 and a 24-year-old and a 26-year-old. So,
wow.
Yes.
Yeah. That's cool. Well, how exciting to have both you guys here. That's
yes, cool. Thank you.
All right, cool. All right, looks like
I'm last.
Yeah, but not least.
Well, I kid. It's hard because I only see you on screen, so I didn't know where I was in the thing. My name is Neil Rosenquist. I am a biology and chemistry teacher and the C team volleyball coach at Central Kitsap High School, and have been there since 2000. So. I'm married to Susan, who's a member of the church. We've been married since May 14th, 2011, and Bill married us right here in this house. In fact, I'm looking at the spot right there. What I want to get out of this is that, you know, I've been going to the church since 2011, and it's probably time to become a member. I held off because it seems like every time, and I'll give my whole history about that. Every time I join a church, I always leave it. So, the longest time I was just like, yeah, I just won't become a member. So I'll just, but now it's time. But, I have three kids, my son, they're all out of the house now. So we're now empty housed. We're an empty nest. It's just me and Susan running around here. The oldest, my son Bri, he's works for Safe Boats up there in Belfair. And my daughter is going to be graduating from Western Washington University in December. And she just informed me that she would like to go into the family business. So she's thinking about becoming a chemistry teacher, which, hey, right there. And my youngest son, he's going to be entering junior year at Western Washington University. Some of my church background, my mom and dad raised me Episcopalian, and that's where I was baptized when I was a little kid. Really didn't do much for the church scene growing up. When I went off to college, I enjoyed going to the Foursquare Church in Spokane. And after graduating from Eastern, I kind of went up to Republic and INEAT, and those were kind of the dark years where I didn't go to church. But when I came back here to CK, I went to the First Lutheran Church in Bremerton and was there. And again, a member there. And within a year, left that church, ended up at Paulsbo Community Church. I really enjoyed going to that church. It was awesome. But then I met Susan and took her to service a couple of times, and she just absolutely hated it. So at that time, you know, we were getting married. We were trying to find a church that both of us would be comfortable with. She got me to go to a couple of Christmas services, and I enjoyed it and started going, and decided that, so I've been going probably since 2011 and just haven't been a member. So that's kind of what I'm hoping to get out of it. And that's kind of everything in there, but
yeah. Cool.
Hey, I really like the band. You know, you got a drummer, you got a couple guitars, you got a lead singer, and man, they've just been on this whole time. I've just really been enjoying that.
That's great. That's great, Neil. I appreciate that good feedback. And yeah, you know, Silverdale Lutheran's unique in that way. And we'll say a little more about that. But yeah, you know, you can see, just so everybody knows, I don't pressure people to become a member. Neil is a good example. you take your time, the Spirit works. So, hey, cool. On that quick little word about worship, you know, most churches have like what they typically call contemporary, and that means something different to each person. And then a, you know, more traditional with organ, piano, using hymns and stuff. And at SLC, we're kind of unique. We have a little different leadership in the worship service each Sunday. So we have our electric worship band that Neil referred to last Sunday. And we have our little bluegrass band that leads worship once a month. And then we've got organ and piano and guitar other couple of weeks. And so we have a nice assortment of different musical expressions. And we don't kind of divide the church up by worship style or leadership. And there's pros and cons to that. Some people say you just make everybody unhappy doing that. But at the same time, it's kind of cool. All of God's music for all of God's people. I think our kids need to learn the wonderful, great traditional hymns, but also there's some really great new music. And that's kind of, but we will delve in deeply into, believe me, into the worship situation. So that's coming. All right. Well, thank you. I just love hearing people's stories a little bit, and we'll get to do that a little bit more. But that's really helpful to me to know our backgrounds. And not surprisingly, typically in this class, we have people who have no Christian background. We oftentimes have people that are Lutheran, as we do tonight. But then we've got people who are all the other different kinds of Protestant or even Catholic backgrounds that are, their journey somehow has found its way to our church. So I just embrace and celebrate our diverse backgrounds and story. And I really pray that this class will be a help. And in fact, in that regard, let me just say a little prayer here for our next half hour as we do a little content. Gracious and loving God, thank you for these stories that we've heard tonight. And I pray that you'll bless this journey. Let it be fruitful and helpful as we, in our relationship to you, your church, as in our being disciples, followers of you. So we ask for your Spirit to be with us, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So the first thing I want to say, even though you probably can't see that because your people are, I didn't move that one little part, is I like questions. So even though tonight I'm going to give about a 20 minute to a half hour amount of content, I'll try and keep it at that. We'll see. If there's questions that you think of that we don't have time to talk about, please email those to me, write them down, send them. I don't want us to get through these sessions. I'm going to present some material I think is very important and very foundational, but I want to know your questions, and it may be what color, why is the color of the carpet the way, I don't know, it doesn't matter. Whatever question it is, I really want to get those addressed, and I'm always enriched by those questions, and everybody else is too. So please do that. I hope you'll have a Bible on hand. You might not need it tonight, but whether you come in person or you're at home, that's always good because we will be looking at some scriptures. So this is where we're headed. Tonight we're going to talk about the gospel. What's the gospel? And yes, now I have a Bernadoodle, by the way, and a golden doodle. So they're, I'm hearing them barking outside. So
hopefully I love the Bernadoodles. I can't wait to meet yours. We have a golden doodle and a labradoodle.
Yeah. Oh, there you go. I'll bring Marty up. Good. So the quick one on that is, you know, as a COVID puppy, you know, it's like, okay, I guess this is a good time to get a dog since we're at home. But the way my daughter and my oldest daughter and my wife, you know, twisted my arm to do a puppy once again was, well, we can get a boy and name him after Martin Luther. How could I say no to that? So anyway, so we have Marty now. So he's a lot of fun. So our second session, we're going to go over the word, the Bible, and its interpretation. We're going to talk about Martin Luther's story and Lutheran theology. What is that? What's that about? What's the emphasis? What's the uniqueness of that? We're going to go over the sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper or communion. And we'll talk about what other people believe and what we believe. And then we'll look at the creed and the discipleship map. And it's at about this point that we move kind of from beliefs and doctrine and those foundational things to praxis. How do we live out the Christian faith? And so we'll the creed will be the kind of bridge there. And then we'll talk about worship. We're going to talk about the process of worship and the content. And I can tell you that this session, and we'll record these in case you can't be at one, and I can put them, if I get everybody's permission, if you don't mind, to be have it on our YouTube channel. But even if not, I can just send it to individuals. I can make it private. So, but this session on worship has really transformed, I can't even say how many people. And the reason it transforms people, it transformed my life. And I got some of this material back in college, and it really made a difference in my worship life. So I hope you'll hang in there for that one for sure. We're going to then talk about prayer and spiritual gifts and vocation and giving, and then we'll talk about ethics, how Christ and culture relate, and you know, and we might even get into some specific ethical issues at that point. So that's where we're headed. That's the road map. And I'm really excited about it. And I've found with the Zoom classes that I don't know about you with Zoom, and even though we're going to be doing a hybrid, you know, man, an hour and a half is really about as long as I can go. So I'm hoping to not go that long tonight. But especially though, hopefully we can have a good 15 minutes to even more, just to handle questions that you might have that might be related to this information and might not be. After all of that's over, if you want to join Silverdale Lutheran, which just simply means you want to be a mission partner at our congregation, and we'll talk about what that means, then we have kind of an orientation night. So those are the sessions, and let's rock and roll. Let's do it. All right, so I'm gonna, let's see, let's pin me just for the recording sake, and then we'll go there. All right, so when we talk about the foundations class, I'm talking about following Jesus. Jesus called his disciples, says, I'll make you come follow me, and I'll make you fish for people. And at once they left their nets and followed him. We are striving to be Christ followers. And what does that look like? And what does it look like from a Lutheran perspective? That's what we're going to work with. We're going to be talking about what does a relationship with Jesus Christ look like? This great passage from 1 Peter, the beginning of that letter, Peter says, although you have not seen Jesus Christ or Christ Jesus, you love him. Okay, so we haven't seen him, but we've heard him. He's come to us in the word. He's come to us in the meal. If we go to the table, if we're receiving the sacrament, if we've been baptized, perhaps, but even just we hear, he comes to us through the word, and we come to love him. And even though we do not see him now, we believe in him. So our relationship is one of love and trust and belief. And then we rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy, for we're receiving the outcome of our faith, the salvation of our souls. So it's about a relationship. It's not just about salvation, but that's certainly a big part of what, you know, the gifts are of being in a relationship with Christ. So really, you know, what I hope you'll get is what I hope you'll get in every sermon and every liturgy and every Bible study, is that Jesus loves you and that you'll come to love him more and more. And that's really a passion of mine. So when I've taken like 3 trips to Israel, and this is a picture of the mustard plants, the mustard blossoms on the top of Mount Arbel, looking down on the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus says something pretty interesting. about the mustard seed. And this is something I like to put up as I start this class. I have a lot of people come and say, Pastor, I'm struggling to believe. I have so many questions and doubts. I think Sharon mentioned earlier, you know, I just was so thankful that I came into a Christian tradition where I could ask questions and wonder. And so many people wonder, can I have questions and doubts? Is there a place for me in the church? And so I always like to say, well, Jesus's favorite term for his followers in the Gospel of Matthew in particular is, O ye of little faith. In Mark, we hear that Jesus call him ye of no faith, but in Matthew, we hear ye of little faith, and that's the people he called to follow him. There's only two places in the New Testament, I believe, or in the Gospels, where Jesus says somebody had great faith. The average disciples, they're all people of little faith. So he says this, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to that, this mountain, move from here to there, and it will be moved, and nothing will be impossible for you. We think, well, I've got to have this great faith, otherwise, you know, I can't be a Christian. But Jesus says, you know, if all you need is a little. And we're going to talk now, well, what is faith? If faith is so important, we're going to talk about that in a couple slides here. But it's really not the amount of our faith, but it's in what is the object of our faith. What do we have faith in? My faith, the strength and the veracity of my faith ebbs and flows from day to day. The object of my faith is on Jesus, and he is a solid rock. And that's a key. So when we talk about faith, we think about a heart component, a head component. I'm real heady. I got to admit it. I'm a geek. I love theology. I love the Bible. I love to think and ask questions and wonder and ponder. But there's a heart element to my faith because I have a, you know, I always say our faith should always be personal, but never private. But then also there's praxis. You know, there's action here. So you might say knowledge and assent and trust. These are all words we try and talk about when we get at faith. But like I said earlier, it's not really, we're not talking about faith in our faith, in the faith of Jesus. We don't bank on, you know, we're people of little faith, but we bank on the person that we have faith in, and that's the work of Jesus. So that's just some intro stuff. I'm going to put a guy up here for a minute, but let me just stop and just check. Any questions, comments on that? We're good? Okay. All right. Super. All right, so let's just keep rolling here then. So this is a guy I like to call Sylvester, and he's got a question. He's wondering, how do I fit? Let's see. How do I fit, you know, church here into my life? I'm so busy. I've got family and finances and leisure and vocation, and then my church here. I got, you know, I'm a citizen too. I've got to go to school, you know. I've got education stuff. I got to take care of my food, and I got my family. So I got my family, everything, all of this to deal with. How do I fit God or church into the mix? And if that's where we come at this, we're going to be perplexed, and it's going to be hard. It's going to be kind of like, you know, for me, my physical fitness is the first thing that suffers when I get too busy. You know, how do I fit a trip to the Y or, you know, getting on the exercise bike? But if I think about fitness as my whole life, it kind of changes things. And so here's a better way to look at it. If we put God's word or Jesus at the center, and the cross at the center of our lives, then everything flows together, because what we want is we want Jesus influencing our citizenship, our sustenance, and our education and our family and how we deal with our finances and how we play and how we work. And yes, we want Jesus to keep us rooted in a community of faith, but it's just a different frame and a different way to look at it. But that's a modern world problem. Quick story, when I went to my first church in Lodi, California, there was a pastor emeritus there who used to be pastor at the church many, many years before. And that church was a very German from, well, Germans from Russia, actually, congregation. And he told me the story of his first parish, which was in Canada. And he went and he preached about a 45-minute sermon, you know, and he thought everything went okay, but he saw that the elders were meeting after the service, and they were very kind of concerned and upset. And so they called him in. They had a special meeting after the service. And this is an era where, you know, people were in horse and buggy and, you know, you know, came from all over the countryside to come to church. And they looked at him and they said, "Pastor, we come 2 and 3 hours for church. We expect a longer sermon than 45 minutes. So, you know, back then people didn't have as much to do on Sunday, but today we do. So we got a complex life. I think our lives are not necessarily harder, but they're way more complex. And so that affects our discipleship. So there you go. So that's just a little introductory thing. And what you're doing in this foundation class is you're trying to put that in right spot. So I'm gonna take about 15, 20 minutes here, and we're gonna talk about the gospel. If there's one thing that you can get out of this class, it is that you know what the gospel is. When I went to seminary, which is in the Lutheran church, for those maybe who aren't from this tradition, you do 4 years of undergraduate and then 4 years of graduate school. So you get a master's degree in divinity, they call it. My first systematics class, which is the big year-long theology class, our term paper was to write a paper on what is the gospel. And I found that so helpful and important. And I'm going to give you a definition of the gospel. And gospel simply means good news. The Greek word is euangelion, which is where we get the word evangelical. Now, that word has been almost become like a denomination in the parlance of our country. The evangelical church is a totally different than what evangelicals used to be 500 years ago, but that's what they've become known as because they've been very outgoing with evangelism. I guess that would be one reason, but so that's, be that as it may, when I talk about evangelion or evangelical, I'm talking about good news. So hear that and know that. So, you know, that's what gospel means. And here's the definition for the gospel. And I hope you can memorize this. So it's the event of Jesus Christ told with its significance. So the event with its significance. So you could put story here, but I think the word event is really important, and let me say a little bit why. I don't know if any of you recognize this picture. This is what they call the edicule inside the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem. And I won't go into the history of this place and all that's been involved, but archaeologists, as well as historians, theologians, etc., are very confident that this is, if it's not the tomb of Jesus, this edicule is built over, it's where Jesus was buried, was somewhere right around here. And of course, now there's a big church over the top of it in this edicule. And it was originally built by Constantine in the 4th century. When Constantine, had become a Christian, the emperor of Rome, he wanted to know where all these important events of Jesus's life happened. And they talked to the locals, and this is the spot. And if you want to hear more about that, I'd love to tell you some more about that. But the reason I put this picture here is something happened here. in time, in history. That if it didn't happen, then all bets are off. You know, if you asked me, Pastor Bill, could anything happen that would cause you not to believe? You know, a lot of people would say, oh, no, nothing. But I would say, absolutely. If you could show me that Jesus was not raised from the dead, then I'm going to go do something else. Our faith is an event-driven faith. The Judeo-Christian faith is an event-driven faith. Something happened in Egypt, and the people of God left. And they wandered in the wilderness for 40 days, and they entered the promised land, and the story goes on. These events in history are key. Christianity is not just a philosophy, although it has lots of philosophy involved. It is based in an event. So when I talk about the good news, I'm talking about something that started right here 2,000 years ago, or more than likely right here. And so, but then you have to go, so what? What does that mean? Let's see, what do I got here over here? I like to say that this event is the self-revelation of God. It's not just a revelation of God, but this is God, God's self, the second person of the Trinity, as we like to say, the self-revelation of God. So that event is important, but then we got to talk about the significance. The so what? So Jesus lived, was born, you know, like we say in the creed, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under the Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, and on the third day rose from the dead. Okay, that's the event. What does it mean? And so that's where we have to talk about. So when we talk about gospel, we mean, we mean the significance of the event. But it's not just the significance. So that historical event is really important. So I'm going to just throw out a few words from the New Testament. And what I like to say at this point is, I don't know if you know the word resonance, but some things resonate with you. And so some of these will like land. They're like, yes, that is the significance for me. But some, well, that's cool, but it doesn't. Well, we don't just have one word for the significance of the gospel. So here we go. And then I'll stop and you can chime in. And this is helpful, this isn't helpful, questions, etc. So in Acts 2, so in the book of Acts, we start hearing sermons, some of the first sermons. Which preaching the gospel. They tell us about Jesus' death and resurrection. And then they do the so what? They tell the significance. So in this part of the sermon, the story of Christ is told, and its significance is the first word is forgiveness of sins in Jesus' name. So the word forgiveness means to wipe away, to erase. There's lots of different ways to send. It actually comes out of there's a number of different words for forgiveness in Greek, but loose, to send away. So in the name of Christ, our sins are forgiven. That's the significance. Why did Jesus die and why was he raised? Well, a lot of it has to do with bringing us forgiveness. Let's see. Well, I thought that I had some more words up here, but anyway. So this sermon even goes on to talk about who gets the forgiveness. Well, it's according to Peter, for our children and all who are far off. And the word far off is not about distance. It's about those who are humble and those who are needing and wanting that forgiveness, those who are humble. Yeah, so we got a little out of order here. But the other thing that goes along with the forgiveness in that first sermon in Acts is that we receive the Holy Spirit. So, you know, it's interesting. In the Old Testament, the Spirit was poured out on people, but here, you know, or on one particular prophet, you know, king, et cetera. Now, all who believe receive the Holy Spirit. There's a great, I don't know if you remember, there's a great little piece of the story in Exodus where Moses is just overwhelmed with the leadership challenges. And some people say, hey, they're prophesying in the camp. You tell them to stop. And Moses cries out. He says, oh, that all of God's people would prophesy. Oh, that everybody would receive the Holy Spirit. Because he's tired. And well, this is what happens in Pentecost when the Holy Spirit comes. And so the first sermon that's on, as we like to say, Pentecost, 50 days after the resurrection, the Holy Spirit fills the disciples. Peter preaches, he tells the story, and he says, believe and be baptized, and you'll receive the Holy Spirit and the forgiveness of sins. And we'll talk some more about baptism here. You know, in just about all the sermons in Acts, this is what we get: forgiveness of sin, the reception of the Holy Spirit, then that we also hear that we are going to be resurrected, that Christ was raised from the dead, so will we. We're delivered from the judgment of God. And then at the end of Acts, we start hearing this fancy word justification, which I'll unpack here in just a minute. So then we go to Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 and Philippians 1. Paul says in Philippians, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. So the significance of the gospel is that death loses its sting. That's what 1 Corinthians 15 says. So that even though, or as Jesus' own words, those in John, those who believe in me, even though they die, yet they shall live. So death itself has lost its sting. Death is an existential reality that affects us all. Jesus defeated death. We sometimes call this Christus, get the R in there. Christus Victor is the fancy Latin. When we think about the significance of what Jesus did, well, he defeated death for us. Death is a problem, no matter how we, in our culture, we like to minimize it. Say, you know, just talk about passing. That's kind of the nice way to say somebody has died today. And I get that. I don't want to be insensitive. It kind of disarms death. You just pass or something. But no, death is an end, and it's a reality that affects all of our lives. And in Christ, we have a promise that it is not the end of our story. So death is transformed to a gate. So there's some significance. So we got forgiveness of sins. We got resurrection from the dead. And then look at this in Romans 5, 6 through 11. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And we get words like we've been reconciled. You know, why do you need reconciled? Well, you're at enmity. You've got a problem with someone. And our relationship with God has been one of distrust now in our fallen, broken world and state. In our baptism liturgy, we talk about being born children of a fallen humanity. Well, God does the reconciling for us. You know, we're the ones that should reconcile, but God did it. And then we got John 3:16, which most of us love and know so well, and that's that God loves us. The really cool thing about this is not just that God loves us, but we're called children of God, and we are heirs. And, you know, like Jonathan mentioned in his sermon last Sunday, to whom you were born in the ancient world dictated everything in your life. It's a big deal today, but in that day, you know, if you were born of a certain status, you stayed there your whole life. There was no movement. And to try and move was a total, you didn't do that. You could tweak, you could go a little bit in your status, but you can never. So who you were born to was everything. And Jesus says before this in John 3:16, we must be born from above, and we can be born from above. We've got God as our Father, as our parent. And so, you know, wow, you can't have any better lineage than that. So God so loved the world, he gave his only son. So that's a hugely important one. Well, let's put this one on maybe as the, as kind of, I wouldn't say the last word, but an incredibly important word. And we'll get more to this when we get into Lutheran theology. This passage in Romans 3:21 through 28, Martin Luther, 500 years ago, reflecting back on his, as he was older, reflected back, and sometimes we call this his tower experience because he talks about it, that he had this aha experience of reading Romans. And, you know, in the church in his day said that we are right or righteous. We don't have that word in English, but that's what the word justified means. The Greek word for underneath both of those words is the same, dikaios. So, but we don't say righteous, but really we should, because that tells us it, we are made right. You know, we're innocent now. Well, how are we made innocent? And Romans 3:21 talks about that. So let me put some stuff up here. So this is what Paul says in that passage. God himself is righteous, and he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. So our trusting in what Jesus did makes us right. So we are righteous, we are right with God through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. So this fancy word here, redemption, is, by the way, I'll start telling you right, you know, everybody comes at this class differently. So some of this might be going, woo, you know, some of you, this, you might be thinking, well, this is pretty basic. Well, that's because we all come from different spots. I had, in the last class, I had someone say, wow, I didn't know I was going to be in, you know, this class of scholars. And I said, no, don't think, you know, we all come at this. So, but the Christian faith is a language, and we can't get rid of the language. We have to teach the language. And so words like redemption are important. And so the Old Testament background for that is that the people believed that the life was in the blood. And so animals would be sacrificed and the blood would be splattered on the altar to atone for the sins of the people, to buy them back. They're enslaved, they're caught in their sin, and this heals the sin. This is the kind of belief. And I know that's, it kind of seems archaic to us today, but the concept here is that Jesus giving his life, what he did for us, that death and resurrection, redeems us. So we are righteous by faith in Christ through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. So we recover from bondage, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement effective through faith. So atonement means at-one-ment, a repaired relationship. So when we think about the significance of the gospel, I'm just trying to think about how to put this into words. Some of you have kids that are in their teens, and some of you are in your teens. Evan is there, and you know, there's a lot of pressure to make yourself somebody in the world today, and to make yourself okay. And we've got our social media stuff. We've got our, you know, Instagram posts, and our, of course, the young kids don't do Facebook, but you know, you've got, you know, all the various things, and we have an image, and we wanna be okay. And we want other people to think highly of us. We want our peers to think highly of us. And that doesn't go away when we're adults. It just gets a little more subtle and gets hidden a little bit more, but we want to do well in our jobs. We want to be successful in this life, and on and on. And there's all this pressure to in a consumer society that we live in to buy this and buy that, because then we will be okay. You know, this, I mean, I've even seen Chinette plates promise to make you somebody. You know, if you get these Chinette plates, you're gonna really be somebody. So it's amazing what people are trying to do to sell a product, but they're all kind of getting at this fundamental want of need of us to be okay. That's a simple way to say what it means to be righteous, to be righteous here. Well, Paul says that that's what Jesus did for us. What we're striving for has been given to us in the work of Christ as a gift. That certainly is a Protestant, and certainly Catholics would believe that as well. We'll dial into that some more. But in particular, this is a Lutheran note that the gifts, the significance of the gospel are a gift. We don't earn it. We don't earn our righteousness. It's an absolute gift. And, you know, when I think about when I was a kid, I played a lot of football and baseball, and man, I was up here. When we lost, I was down here, and it was almost tyrannical. You know, I mean, I loved it. I loved the competition. I loved doing all of that, but I know I had friends, I wasn't such a great student in high school, but I had friends that were, and you know, if they got a B on a test, it was, you know, the end of the world. Well, this is getting at that what I'm talking about. And what we hear in the gospel, the event of Jesus told the significance, that the significance is that we are right. We're straight A students in Christ. We are victorious. We, you know, and it's all given to us as a gift. We are okay. You know, life beats us down a lot of times, but the gospel comes in and says, you know, you're my child. So this is, I love to unpack Romans a little bit. Here's a huge part of this gift issue. You know, we talk sometimes about our decision, and some Christian traditions, they like to say, you know, have you made a decision for Christ? But in our faith tradition, we like to emphasize God's decision is more important. God has made a decision about each and every person in this Zoom class tonight. Jesus says this in John 15. He says, I chose you. You did not choose me. And so what a gift that I can walk each day, that each one of us can walk each day, know that we're part of a community where God's made a decision about us. I'm going to be your God and you are my child. And yeah, we mess up. We do all kinds of rotten things and we miss the mark and we go astray. But God says, I've still got you. I've made a decision about you. So I love that. So when it comes to Christian life, and I don't even think I'm going to go into these slides so much, you might say, well, what are we supposed to do? Well, because the gospel, the event of Jesus told the significance, and because that word comes to us, then therefore we're going to do stuff. We're going to worship. We're going to pray. We're going to talk and do all the things we're going to talk about in this class. But we believe it's so important that you get the because first. The problem with most religions and even a lot of Christianity is that they start with the therefore. You do this and then God will accept you. And we're going to say, no, God has made a decision about us. The beginning of the Ten Commandments, you remember the beginning? I am the Lord your God. You know, that's the first of the commandments. Before we get what we're supposed to, God has made a decision about us. So, and we receive all of that in our baptism. We put that on in the faith of our baptism, as Paul says in Galatians 3. So, and then we'll talk about our response. So I'm going to stop the share there. A lot of talking here tonight on my part. How does that land with you? Does any particular word resonate more with you than others? And if you wanted to share a little bit of why, that's great, but no problem if not. But let me just pause and see how all of that's landed.
I like that it's not faith in our faith. It's faith in Jesus. I've never thought about that or heard that. So thank you for that. It's not faith in our faith. Our faith can falter and flounder and go up and down, but it's the faith in Jesus. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Amen. You know where that really hits the, as a pastor, I'm gifted with being with a lot of people who are finishing their journey on earth. And inevitably, you know, what we'll talk about is the law versus the gospel starts to hit on you when you're at that point. It's like, have I done enough? What about this? What about that? You know, and I have the privilege, as people's pastor to say, don't look at yourself, look at the cross. Look what Jesus did for you. And it just changes people because, we wonder about our faith. Did I believe enough? Did I do enough? All of that. Yeah. So beautiful. Beautiful. Thank you. Glad that hit home. Any other thoughts, resonances?
Oh. I don't know if this is whether it's correct to say, but it almost takes a lot of pressure off of me as an individual to be perfect and to do everything right. So, yeah.
Yeah. I think that's a beautiful comment, Sharon. Yeah, that's okay. Dogs are welcome in class.
I'm gonna have to come to the meeting next week there just so I can get away from the barking and the whatever is going on here.
That's fine. Well, don't know about that. But what I love about your comment, I gotta just use that as a springboard to just say a little bit about Luther before we talk about Luther. So basically what the church told Luther is God will accept you if you do this, 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 and this, and this. And there was all the pressure on him. And when he read Romans, which said, by the way, and I didn't even get to that, says apart from the law, apart from what we do. And so he wrote in his Bible alone, faith alone, which is actually a really great translation of the Greek there. The Catholic Church, what they were worried about is you're taking the pressure off people, Luther. They're not going to do anything. They're going to kick their feet back and just, oh, goody. We don't have that little hook, that little threat to hold over people, to make them do what we want them to do, And Luther said, nope, look, he just went to Paul because Paul was accused of the same thing. And he said, no, when you have faith in Christ, the Spirit comes and it flows out of you naturally. Think about the sheep and the goats parable. I love this parable, which oftentimes we hear as law, but, the sheep, Jesus said, inasmuch as you've done it to the least of me, you've done it unto me. And the sheep say, when did we do that? And they didn't even know. See, it just flowed out naturally. It wasn't like, okay, there's a box to check here. So yeah, I love that comment, Sharon, that it does take pressure off of being perfect. And now we can really love and turn to our neighbor authentically, I think. So no, beautiful, great, 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 good stuff. Any others? No problem if not. My wife always says, now Bill, and she's an educator, she's taught for 30 years and then the principal and now, superintendency and stuff. But she says, if you ask a question, be quiet long enough to let people think. Okay. So quiet is okay. So I'll give you a few more, a little bit longer to think if anybody else wants to chime in on this, and then we'll bring her to a close.
Well, I was just going to say, I love the idea of that gift. And I think that 20 years ago when I chose to be baptized in the Lutheran church, coming into it, I was struggling with anxiety and depression. And coming into church, I just felt like everything washed away. I felt like, God, Jesus was seeing me and loving me and that I was his child. And you know, so I think just remembering that that gift, you know, and it makes you want to give. And so it's just kind of always, it always just makes me tear up. So when you were, you know, doing your size, I just teared up a little bit and just remembering that amazing gift.
Yeah. Cool. Beautiful. That's awesome. Thanks be to God. Yeah. 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 Seeing your daughter next to you is really cool. And I think about the world that, you know, it's Evan, right? Evan? Yeah. The world that Evan lives in, there's a lot of pressure, isn't there? You know, to succeed and, you know, you're seven. How old are you? How old are you, Evan?
17.
So that means you're starting to look towards college and all of that. Yeah. See, I mean, when I was 17, I played baseball and I got this tiny little golf spot. I don't think I thought about college till I was about May of my senior year. Now it's a little different, you know, but hey, the cool thing that I get to tell you tonight is, you know what, you're going to get out there in the world and do your best, but you're God's child and that's a gift. So no matter what you do on the score or what school you go to or what you decide to do, you know, at every stage in our life, it's such a gift. So very cool. Yeah. All right. And thanks, Neil, for shepherding our youth in school. Doing such a great job with that. All right. Any other thoughts? Well, just beautiful. Okay. Well, I think what I'd like to do is just close up shop here at this point. So next week, we will be in person. You don't have to tell me ahead of time, but I'll have it set up to where you just same link and we'll send out a reminder. You can invite other people, by the way, if you want to say, hey, this was cool. You want to join in, feel free to do that. But we'll have an in-person and a at home and we'll see how it goes. I did it with the Bible study today and it was a good learning experience, but I think we got it figured out. So we'll do that. And please bring your questions. The first 2-3 sessions, there's a lot of content that I wanna do, but I'd rather get to pressing issues that you have or stuff that comes up. So, you know, I just really want you to bring those as we go. So, all right, any other closing thoughts? All right, let me close this with a prayer. Gracious God, thank you for this great start and for the gospel, for the person and work of Jesus that is the fulfillment of the whole story of the scriptures and that has brought us an incredible gift of life eternal, of forgiveness, of reconciliation, and being made right and righteous, all as an incredible gift. And so we receive it and give thanks for it this night and pray that you'll be with us until we meet again. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Thank you, guys. We will see you either on a Sunday or I'll wave at you from the video thing. And by the way, Jamie, we'll be live streaming forever now. So that's going to be.
Yay. Oh, I'm so glad.
The forever thing, you know, so we started something by the Barna group called Hybrid Church. And that's going to be the new reality. And it's exciting. So we have new members from our last class that are in medical school that live in Seattle going to UW. They come over here in the summer. They grew up and they want to come back here eventually, but they worship every Sunday online. They became members of our church because, you know, I mean, that's the new era. We have people in our military that are watching from Afghanistan and other places and you know, in their deployments. So it's very cool. All right. Have a great night. Enjoy this little bit before we get back to rain.
Thank you.
Okay. Peace.
Bye.
See you later.